and they are going to debate the formation video put out by Beyonce last month and a half ago. Because we discussed it in class, and as you know, it's gotten some really intense feedback from both African Americans and scared white people. And so we thought it would be a very appropriate video to discuss here at the symposium. We're going to start by showing the video. Pray to God it works. I'm assuming it does. And there you go. Teaches me not to say that. I have a series of questions. People in the audience, if you have a question you want to ask, just if you want to jump in and talk, just raise your hand. You know, I'd love for this to be a, you know, a good open debate.
What happened at the New Orleans?
She said you can't do it. Oh. Look at her.
Oh yeah, I like that.
sorry.
You know you that bitch when you cause all this conversation.
That, okay, that's
all my favorite. Let's be
class with several questions that we thought might be interesting to talk about. What I'll do is I'll pose a question, and if you all, what I'll do actually is I'll move so you all don't have to turn around. How does that sound?
Okay.
That's really annoying.
Yeah, it hurts my neck.
And you know, you can take turns answering. I mean, if you know, I guess you can go down the line.
No.
I guess
you can sit.
Nah, I'll just stay there. How's that? I'll stand right on top of the chair. All right, cool. For the first question we came up with, think about this, how is this different from our previous work?
Yeah.
Yeah, why don't we just start by going down the line?
Okay.
Thank you.
How is this different from her?
From her previous work?
Well, I don't think I've ever seen a video that was so pro any cause from Beyonce, if I'm thinking.
Yeah, because she went from like bootylicious to
like this.
Yeah, because you're really quiet.
Really? Hear it out, Cherish.
Okay. I'm not sure if I've ever seen a video where she was like pro a cause and so blatant in it. So to see such strong, I guess, imagery in this video was real different. The beat was different. I know the producer that she made the beat with, Mike Will made it. Mm-hmm. I don't know if she's ever really worked with him before. So, just the whole thing
okay.
was different.
I don't really I'm a little loud. Basically, like Cherish was saying, this is nothing that she's ever done before. Like, she went from bootylicious. Everything she's ever done, mm-hmm. it stood for women, but this was like for everybody. It was like Black Lives Do Matter. It was
pro-black.
Her scenes expressed different things for Black lives in general. It was no set like independent women or you know anything like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, really, they just said everything that I agree with. So.
Did you say that?
Yeah.
She's so gracious.
I would say that it's different because she is overtly political as to being covertly political, because bootylicious is political. I mean, because it is a celebration of bodies mm-hmm. that aren't normally celebrated, and those celebrated bodies being those that are often associated with African American women.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so for her to have a song like that to celebrate that actually is political. It's just not overtly
political.
So this time she actually has a very overt stance where she is celebrating her cultural heritage and celebrating her blackness. And as I've read some articles, I won't use the word fantasy, but basically she has zero left. Okay, she has none left. She doesn't care anymore. She's made whatever she's gonna make. She's a one-name artist as it is. And so now I think she, as with any career, one, you know, takes stock, and I think she took stock and decided to respond to what she sees going on in society. And so I think that's one of the major changes she's made, that perhaps where she may have had fear of retribution or fear of different things in the music industry, I don't think she no longer has that fear.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We made it. We
have made it. Okay,
yeah.
So I grew up with Beyonce as much as many of you did, so I can kind of get from this video and her previous work. When she first came out, Beyonce appealed to everybody, not just Black people, white people, Hispanic people, Asian people. Everybody loved Beyonce. Everybody still loves Beyonce. This video appeals to specifically Black people, and that makes white people very angry. So she just dropped a bomb on white people. They were like, oh, she's not just an entertainer. Yeah, she's speaking about issues in the community now, for the most part. So yeah.
All right. Well, why don't we keep it over there? We can go backwards on the next question. The next one might be obvious, but maybe we've missed some. What current events is she showing in this video? What all did you guys see?
The fact with the little boy and police brutality. and the fact of New Orleans, how it still hasn't recovered from the flood, and it's been quite a few years.
I guess my follow-up question, I'll ask you guys to address this too, is New Orleans is obviously in this video. Mm-hmm. Why now? It's 11 years ago.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why do you think she's doing that now?
She has roots there, so I guess she feels somewhat, has roots there, so I guess she's like somewhat connected to the city, and she's probably seeing how it has shifted from its thriving moments to like now and still recovering from that epic flood a few years ago. So,
okay. You can just hand it back, and we'll just, you all can answer the question.
Now I forgot the question.
What current events does it reflect? And then why New Orleans now?
Okay.
Because it's 11 years ago.
Well, I was going to take a whole different direction as far as... I see it also talking about the carefree black girl, mm-hmm. and black girl magic. Mm-hmm. You know, when I was growing up, you had to know what you were doing. You didn't have time for silliness. You didn't have time for, dreaming per se, as far as, things that they may see not necessarily as serious enough. I'll give you a quick example. I don't know how many of you are familiar with A Different World.
Yeah.
The first season, Denise was on the first and second season. I remember at the time I was in high school, I could not relate with her at all. What do you mean you're flunking out? What do you mean you don't want to know what you want to do? Who is that person? I've never met that person. We don't do that. We're Jaleesa. You know, we actually get our work done. We don't have time to play
not
around.
Not you, Jaleesa.
Yeah. As I grew up, and now that I have a little girl, I said, why shouldn't my baby girl have the space to be silly, explore, be creative, be free, basically? And so what I see in there is a celebration of that freedom by including her own daughter and including other little black girls. I think she is also expressing that black girls should be free to express themselves too.
All right. Current events, Roche, and why New Orleans now?
Okay, well, to piggyback off what she said, I think that she's really being optimistic and just having a voice. Also, I think at the end, when the little boy was dancing, it's basically a message saying the kids are our future. Mm. So they're gonna be the next generation to like change the world, because you saw how like it was all white cops, right? Wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess like just saying that the kids are the future. And I'm not really sure why now with the New Orleans thing, but I do know she was sharing a part of her culture, so.
Okay. What current events?
Okay. Well, of course, they already touched on the Black Lives Matter and, of course, the New Orleans thing. But as far as her, you know, doing all that in the video, I feel like she was just doing it to address the topics that she feels are not getting enough addressing. As like, I feel like she's trying to address them because she feels like they're not getting the recognition that they need, just like New Orleans. That's probably why she brought it back up. She felt like it didn't get the attention that it should have. Like, it did get attention, but I feel like it didn't get enough attention, and that's why she brought it back, and that's why he said in the beginning, whatever happened to New Orleans, like, nobody, it was over. It was like, cut and dry.
Do you have anything to add?
Right. It's being at the end.
I think that the way the song comes on always really kind of got me. Like, what happened at the New Orleans? I think that that's the big thing, the whole Hurricane Katrina. I don't know why she chose right now. I think she probably chose right now because there is no restoration going on right now in New Orleans. It's still a lot of work that needs to be done there. Mm. And Hurricane Katrina almost was one of the biggest, like, I can't explain it, catastrophe for black people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, it was different because it wrecked so many of their lives.
People still,
you know, it just changed everyone down there. I think that one of the main messages that I got out of this was maybe the scene where she's dancing in the hallway and they have, like, the antebellum outfits and stuff. That's different because I've never seen an African-American woman dressed like that to be posing as if she has power. You know, like, the way she sits on the couch and she's kind of, like, with her and her crew,
mm-hmm.
and they're sitting there. And you hardly ever see black women sitting sitting in a house that looks as if it could be like a slave house.
Yeah.
And she's not even working. She's not, you know, showing that old slave thing. She looks as if she's running things. Well, like, you know, so I think that was something different than I caught on to.
Could it be that, and this is just freewheeling here, that she's using what happened in Hurricane Katrina as a symbol for what's happening now with Black Lives Matter, and that she's saying that the devastation from the, you know, New Orleans was obvious, right? We all saw the levees break and people without houses,
and
the drama,
that.
And it was just, I mean, you can go there now, they're still, you know, it's terrible.
It's still rough.
Could it be that, that was so obvious. A lot of white people look at, not all of us, but, you know, look at Black Lives Matter and say, I don't see the problem.
Yeah.
Could it be that she's trying to make the point, this is a big deal as New Orleans, like, we're going to drown in this, you know, that final scene of her on top of the police car.
Yeah, I mean, and then it could be that thing, like, they didn't understand Hurricane Katrina because they didn't see it as a racial thing, but for a lot of African Americans that were living in New Orleans at that time, they knew that it was racial.
Oh, it was, if that has been Martha's Vineyard.
Exactly.
I mean, seriously.
So, you know, and then the Black Lives Matter, that's something that a lot of people, not even just other, I guess, white people, but a lot of other people, even some Black people don't understand why Black Lives Matter is something that needs to be talked about. It's something that needs to have some kind of conversation because they just think, you know, well, it's something that could have been avoidable, but it can't be, you know, it's been going on for so long.
How does this culture reflect today's Black, how does this video reflect today's Black culture? What aspects of Black culture does she use in this video? It's changing the gods. Black culture.
Okay, I'm like, repeat the question.
What aspects of, how does it reflect today's Black culture?
In so many ways, more than I, man.
Like, you want to pass it on?
Yeah,
because I don't.
I can't answer.
It's so
go
much.
For it.
Okay.
Okay.
Go for it,
so it's like, y'all know how we have our little slang, like, you know, we say we slay and things like that. So it's like modern. It's more like catchy. It's a way where we can, like, connect with her, in a sense. Like, what do you, Discord? Social codes. Social codes.
Okay, what social, explain what social codes are, because not everybody knows mass comm.
Definition.
No, I think I got it.
Okay,
so social codes is basically the way you dress, the way you talk, the way you look. Am I missing something?
No, you got it.
Yeah.
Go
you got it.
Good job.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, you passed me a time.
I love it.
Very good. Yes, you just said mentor. So how does that video reflect Black social codes? What does she do?
Ooh.
That is specifically
Black. Oh my God,
Black.
I can help you with that one.
Okay, well, let's see. Well, okay, the way she kind of is dancing, like a little bit of the twerking that comes from, you know, African dances. That's actually where it all started. And then what else? Her slang.
Her hairstyle changed like 50 times. She was
oh, yeah.
Braids.
Inches.
To the fro.
Okay.
Yeah, her hair. It was a lot.
All her backup dancers had froze.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she had her background dancers with afros and all kinds of
stuff. And she, even off the top of Beyonce, like all her backup dancers had natural hair.
I was just about to say that.
And the fact that some of the clips that you saw were like rural settings of, like, you know, like a hair store, and there's
church.
There's a church. There was the Mardi Gras funerals.
Oh, fried chicken hot sauce.
Yeah, that's a stereotype, but it's
well, it's a true
and
one.
The,
what are they called? How about the church?
Yeah, we mentioned the
second line.
Second line people, the marching
Mardi
band,
Gras.
That's a big thing with us.
Mardi Gras.
And the, like, every, she had a lot of Black culture aspects in her video, so she's like touching upon that
she
now.
And did you all, I'm sorry, as a mass comm, I get really excited about stuff like that. Did you notice that they had the scene of the church where all, it switched to a view of the audience where they all had their hands in the air, and then the next shot, the white police officers have their hands
in the
air too.
Yeah.
What was she trying to say there?
Good luck with that question.
She said they all need Jesus.
Well,
yeah, that too.
That too.
I mean, it had to do with the.
Okay.
I think I'm like.
Dr. Hankerson, you were free.
Oh no!
Yeah, you just steal the mic.
I think typically, whenever someone puts their hands up, it's usually like a sign of like I give up, or you know, I'm kind of releasing everything to something else, or I'm surrendering. So usually in church, when people do that, you know, they're usually praising, and at that point, they could even be, you know, giving their problems over to God, you know, in their efforts of praising them. And then it's like for the cops to be seen in that next scene doing the same gesture. It's like, I think that let's see. There's a relation in that.
There is.
I can't find
the audience. Like, we didn't catch that one in the
cut. Yeah, there's definitely
but it could be something like.
Someone in the back, did you want to give it a try?
I would give it a try.
All right, okay. No. Just you have to speak up.
Okay, so I think that with the black people, when they were raised, when they were in the church and raised their hand, they were actually saying kind of giving up to God. It was a form of like praise and worship. And like, what they were doing, it, I can't remember how the police officers actually had their hands. But maybe it's a sign of like kind of submission or trying to
Make
a sign of force. So on one hand, it's like a sign of praise. On the other hand, it's like trying to put someone else down or control.
Yeah, I didn't even take it like that.
That's an opportunity. Or you could say the little boy is Jesus.
Or you can say that doesn't work. That it doesn't work.
What doesn't work?
Because, you know, the African-Americans are so, like, that's one of the stereotypes. And I feel like Beyonce really took a lot of the stereotypes that happened in the African-American community and just kind of tried to own them herself. And one of the biggest things is that African-Americans are religious, overly religious. Like, they don't really have any belief in anything that has any foundation in it but just religion.
Right.
And so, with the police, with people who, you know, put their hands up, they still get shot.
Right.
So, you know, you have black people in church who are putting their hands up and praising God and things like that, but it's not working. Because black people are just always seen as being overly religious and not so much in education or anything like that. You see what I'm saying?
I like that. Okay. I see where you went with that.
I thought it was. I didn't know all of us had to answer all of them. I just assumed we were free willing. Well, first of all, I see a reclamation of the black southern experience. Mm-hmm. As you know, with hip hop culture, most of it has been in the past. It has been what? Urban, it has been East Coast, moved a little bit West Coast. So here you have a contemporary artist who is actually reclaiming her southernness. That is not just a black experience, but it's also a black southern experience.
Which is so different.
I think that with that, so to me it's not stereotypical to talk about chicken or hot sauce or hair.
It's actually
that's black southern culture.
Yeah.
And I think that she's embracing that black southern culture. And then also I just want to give you a heads up, since a lot of folks have Netflix and all that. I wanted to tell you about a film called Daughters of the Dust. It's by Julie Dash. And basically, if you were to Google it right now and look at the images, all of those women are wearing white on the beach, and they're in the South. And it's about a family that has to decide from the Georgia Sea Islands. Many of you may have heard of them as the Gullah people. It's about a day in the life at the turn of the last century when a family has to decide, they have decided that they are going to move, they say move north, but basically means move off the island to the mainland, which would be Georgia or Alabama or somewhere of that nature. And basically that is a picnic. I mean, you see them preparing a picnic and everyone is wearing white. And I can't help but look at that imagery and think of those 19th century outfits or early 20th century outfits of women in white with their families. And so Daughters of the Dust, Julie Dash, I think a lot of that imagery comes from that film.
Do you guys see any stereotypes in the video? Male, female stereotypes? I mean, we're praising Beyonce. She did a great job. Did she fall into using stereotypes?
Yeah, by her appearance, because it was like sexual, and you know, sex sells, so that's kind of stereotype that women are, they use their sexual objects.
Yeah, Imani was talking about it this morning. She was like, Beyonce is the mulatto, the modern day mulatto, simply because of her skin tone, and basically that's the only way that people
will hear you out.
Yeah, with her having her thighs out and her butt showing, and so she touched on that. Yeah.
Yes.
I love Beyonce and what she did, but my only issue was, why did you have your backup dancers where they're naturally at, but you didn't?
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, I understand that you're trying to, you know, don't half step.
you're gonna do it, you can do it. You know? And yeah. I feel like she did a great job. And the fact she did it at the Super Bowl was even better because not just the US saw it, the whole world saw it. Mm-hmm. So she brought the whole world to the attention to something that's going on here. You know, we like to act like we got all our problems figured out. Mm. But yeah, that was my only issue with the fact that she didn't wear her natural
hair. I didn't even pay attention to that either.
Why do you think she chose not to do that?
I'm not sure. That's just a question that I have. I wonder why she didn't.
It probably would have stirred up a little more controversy than this already is.
Yeah.
She probably felt like
certain scenes in the video
where she had natural styles but not natural hair.
She had braids.
She has an afro.
She has an afro.
She has like this little beehive thing when she's sitting on top of the car.
I saw that.
That thing.
The braids.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The braids. Really,
maybe because she was still trying to imply, like, I guess, because, you know, like,
she was trying to relate.
Still imply with, like, with weaves, like,
Well, and I think what Imani, the presentation this morning, talked about beauty expectations for different types of women. And she talked about light-skinned women and how they're generally expected to have straight hair and light eyes. And I think that, you know, Beyonce can push boundaries all she wants. At the end of the day, she's still tied to whatever we in society dictate as acceptable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So, I mean, I'm trying to picture her with natural hair, and I'm having a hard time picturing, because it's not what our brains are trained to expect, right? So you can push all the envelope, but at some point I think it ends.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, and I don't think it was even a conscious decision.
Austin Powers, I mean, she kind of quit her.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I was just saying, in Austin Powers film.
Yeah.
Yes.
The afro wig.
Right.
Yeah. And check up on it. Did she have the afro?
Oh, yeah, she did. Austin Powers.
She had five different hairstyles in the video.
Where Beyonce literally.
Pink fan.
But see, yeah, Austin Powers isn't really a fair example.
Yeah, but that was.
Because Austin Powers, as my African American ninja students know, is completely over the top and excessive, which means that she's not to be taken seriously.
Right.
Right? It's what we call polysemy.
Right.
You're meant to laugh at her and go, oh my God. So I don't think that necessarily counts as, oh, here she's pushing the boundaries.
Well, I think I think by having the hair store as a part of the video, she is, again, pointing towards authenticity in that, if anything, black women do a lot of, just culturally and socially, is, you know, hair and different hair,
right,
and the versatility of hair.
Yeah.
And so I think that now it has become a part of that continuum of what one is doing with one's hair. You know, am I wearing a protective style, and do I have a
shirt,
afro? Yeah, and then also, we have to be fair, you know, what is natural about when you wake up with your natural hair? It's not round and fluffy like that. I mean, you have to blow dry it. You still have to style it. You still have to,
You still have to do so much.
You still have to do the twist out. So, of course, there's some, but I want to look at it in a positive way, is then there's some artistry there,
right?
There's some self-care there,
mm-hmm,
there's a connection there. So and then also, I grew up as a kid in the 70s, and I was disappointed when I tried to do my little afro by myself and it wasn't working. But I didn't know that Diana Ross and all may have had an afro wig.
Yeah, right.
See, mm-hmm, and so I didn't know anything about wigs and all that until one of my aunts, she had, you know, I saw her afro wig on the shelf. And so,
like, oh.
So images, yeah,
funny.
So images of beauty, understandable, but I think she's trying to press as far as celebrating that versatility.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And because she never once has perfectly permed hair either.
Yeah. No.
Right.
You know, it's all, like you said,
natural style.
And artistic.
She was, yeah.
Hang on, we had a lady up there getting carpal tunnel.
Tour.
Which touched on what I was going to say.
The hair.
Yeah, the hair. How big it is in our African American community.
Mm-hmm.
Is that
your name?
Mm-hmm.
Hey. How you doing, Dr. Rosenbaum?
Hey.
I'm the one. I heard about you from Ms. Hale.
Oh,
that's how this is. But this is truly my opinion for this video. I feel like everybody, well, not everybody, but most people hit Beyonce too much. I feel like the video is good. Yes, it portrays a certain message, and yes, it does have certain things. Everything that you all are saying is right. But I feel like because this is new, and because this is like the first time this is happening, I feel like a lot of us are settling for less. Like, she called herself a B-word in the video. That's not something that I would want my daughter or my son to watch. Because even though she said, okay, I slay, that has nothing to do with getting a degree. That has nothing to do with, like, these black cops who are killing, or these white cops who are killing, whatever. But yes, the video is good, but I feel like we as African Americans, we as U.S. citizens are settling for less in the video, because I feel like it's just not enough. Like, get information and then do what? Like, what do you do after you get information? Events. New Orleans is still in the state that it's in. Maybe because it's $1 billion still sitting on the elevator. Like, just she has the money to help everything that she says in the video. Yes, she does help, but I feel like she's not doing enough. I feel like because this is the first time this is happening, we're settling for less. Like, we're settling. Okay, cool. This is good. Like, a lot of black guys saw the Kendrick Lamar thing going on. Yes, it was powerful. I love Kendrick Lamar. It was amazing. But I feel like now that we're making this transition to say it on the Grammys or say it at the Super Bowl or say it in front of non-African Americans, we said, okay, we're there as far as music, like we're there at the promised land, like we're there, we're good now. And I feel like that's the mindset that we're gonna have, and it's gonna make us kind of like take steps backward because we're settling for that type of thing. It was good.
I get what you're saying. And her use of the B word is definitely interesting because in some womanist movements, the B word is seen as a word of empowerment.
Oh, yeah.
Like you take it back, right? Like men have called us bitches. For years, and now we're going to do it ourselves, right? I mean,
So,
but you can make the same argument for that as you could for the N-word, right? That are you taking power back, or are you basically accepting hegemony? Are you accepting a system that keeps you in place?
Yeah.
Dr. Hankerson had your hand up.
Oh.
Did you want to respond to him?
I want to respond to him.
Artists create art. And I think that's as far as we can take it. It's great if they go beyond that. It's great if you could be an Eartha Kitt, or you could be a Denzel Washington, or you could be another artist who actually, you know, does things beyond that. But artists make art, and you'll be surprised what art can do, or we wouldn't have this panel. And so I think that no one is selling for less. What we are doing is celebrating what's there. Even during the Civil Rights Movement, right after the Civil Rights Movement, there was the Black Power Movement.
Right.
And then there was also the Black Arts Movement.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So the Black Arts people made political art to mirror what was actually happening with the politicians, the activists in the Black Power Movement.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that is just as important. Images are important. Words are important. So we're not, when James Brown said, I'm black and I'm proud, they didn't say, well, what were you doing before you got your afro and still had a perm? And even after he came out for Nixon, because, you know, James Brown was a Republican, he still got credit for what? That cultural moment of having black people affirm and love themselves. And so I would be selfish to have experienced being able to have all my dolls be black and have all these, you know, afros and watch Soul Train and have all these things affirm my blackness as a child and not see it happen for the next generation. So if this could be the beginning of the next generation uplifting themselves and giving themselves imagery and ideas that can help those who are in the Black Lives Matter movement, more power to them.
The young lady over there had a question or a comment.
I really enjoyed his male standpoint because I didn't think of the video into, well, yeah, this is good, but we are settling for it. But the only thing I disagreed with was he was saying, like, the word slay. Like, slay to females is a form of perfection. Like, your hair is perfect when it's slayed. Your nails are perfect when it's slayed. But I don't only think of slaying as a form of physical appearance. Like, I know I've had several friends that graduated, and on their graduation pictures, it's like they're in their cap and gowns. It's like, I'm slayed. Like, I, you know, went to school, I got my degree. You know, at this point, I'm feeling on top of the world.
Right.
I'm perfect. So maybe she could have been portraying that as well as just her image, but I did agree with everything else. All right,
so she's not going far enough. But and it's interesting that you brought up the Super Bowl, or someone did, you did or she did. where she brought out her dancers who were dressed as Black Panthers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about that for a minute, because what was she trying to do? Was she successful at it?
Well, there's their anniversary. That's one thing.
It's their anniversary.
All right, Cherish. Someone want to hand her the mic? Cherish. For some reason, it's gotten really quiet.
Maybe I don't need it.
Be loud and proud.
I think that one thing that's like my main problem with the entire video. It's just she really did commodify Black culture.
Explain.
Okay, so commodification is where you take a cause or you take something that usually is political, and in order to gain profit from it, you water it down so that it could be interpreted by the masses.
Right.
So now you're making money off of it. So a great example would be the Malcolm X shirt. When, I don't know if you all have ever seen the shirts that say by any means necessary, maybe a picture of Malcolm X standing by the window holding the gun. But you know, that's just a small part of a very long speech that he said, you know, and it represented more than that image, but that's what people bought into. And so that is their way of, I guess, having pride in Malcolm X or anything of his message. So I feel like with Beyonce, in this video, there's a lot of commodification for Black culture simply because it seems like to me, she just went back to New Orleans and decided, you know, I want to speak to people that I probably missed in the whole boat of becoming a very famous entertainer. Mm. And people in New Orleans, they already feel forgotten just because of what happened with Katrina.
Right.
And it seems as if, you know, she went back to New Orleans, she decided to film this video in these very rural areas. She used people who are not, you know, famous, like the images with the guy who's holding the newspaper, and then you have the other man that's standing next to her.
The voiceovers
is something that also kind of got my attention, because the first voiceover that you hear is Messy Maya. The second one is Big Frida.
Mm-hmm.
Big Frida is a bounce musician from New Orleans, and it's a man. He's gay, and it's, so that's the, you know, that's a part of the LGBT community.
Mm-hmm.
And she only used the voiceover. She didn't put him in the video. Messy Maya, however, is deceased, also from New Orleans, and used to be somewhat of a satirical journalist in a sense. He used to do a lot of things on YouTube and just talk about a lot of people in New Orleans, and he ended up being murdered in like 2007. But Big Frida, however, is just not in the video at all whatsoever. And I don't know what about that really kind of ruffles my feathers. I think the fact that Big Frida is an independent artist who needs that backing, who would have needed this chance to be in this video to really make a big mark on their musical career, but she didn't allow him that. And even when you kind of listen to the interview with Big Frida about how he got onto the song, it's really like, well, Beyonce really didn't, I don't know what she was trying to do, because she didn't send him a lot of information about it. And her dancers in the video have on Gucci. And at the Super Bowl, they have on like Black Panther outfits, and they're all very militant. But in the video, they have on a Gucci onesie, and Gucci sent it to her. They didn't even pay for it. So I think that was also something that kind of got me. I don't know. It's like she's playing both sides of the field for me.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, the video and the song sounds amazing, but how did you make it?
Mm.
Did you use your connects as Beyonce, or were you really trying to, you know, convey a message?
Yeah.
Be an activist. I don't know.
I would say yes and yes. And what I mean by that is there's certain things she has access to because she's Beyonce.
Right.
And thus, whatever she does will get attention because she's Beyonce.
Right.
So she acknowledges that in her lyrics.
Yeah.
Where she says, I can do this. Measure your success by your paper.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So you may not agree with everything she does,
but it's not such a bad thing.
But we can't play both sides to the middle and say, how dare you do this? You're Beyonce.
Right.
But oh, you're doing this. You should, because you're Beyonce.
Right.
It's just the easiest way to not be criticized is to do nothing at all.
True.
And I think that even with the Super Bowl outfits for her backup dancers, this is something I had to challenge myself on, because I kept saying, why you have to be, you know, half naked and stuff? But then I said, okay, when people go see the Nutcracker or see Misty Copeland,
do they say they need to wear some sweats right. when they do that period?
No. Right, they don't.
We don't.
That.
Yeah. So when you move the lens a little bit, it makes you question: is it because it's a certain style of dancing
I wanna
that
say,
we have?
Misty Copeland doesn't twerk either.
Yep. Now
that's what I say. It's a certain style. What I'm saying is a certain style of dancing.
But, then that shows
but if you, I could pull up some pictures of her right now where she's posed, you know, on point. She's wearing shorts about this big, and you know, it's dancing clothes.
Right.
And so I had to check myself and say, these people are dancing. You know, they're not turning in an accountant report or something. They're dancing. They need freedom of movement. It's
right.
dancing clothes. Now you have the overt sexual aspects of it, mm-hmm. but.
Because, I mean, her boobs are about to fall out of that red
Yeah, but.
I mean, there was some tape there.
Yeah, but they did. So
right.
we could just
exactly.
be, you know, we could be thankful. Some men may not be as thankful that they didn't, but
right.
they did.
Right.
And so that, it, I guess it becomes about that line that we know someone like Madonna may have pushed
right.
and others pushed. You know, when is it objectification versus me expressing my sexuality?
Right. Yeah.
And that line is always
it's
fuzzy.
Thin. Very blurry.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think
clothing.
For me, because I saw the Super Bowl and I was like, oh, oh, you know, my kids were like, what in the world?
Mm-hmm.
And then the first thing I said is, but they're dressed like strippers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and like you said, I too went, but I go to the ballet and they dress like that too. So what's
right.
the difference?
Mm.
And
it's the way they're moving.
Well, but could
not
it be
even.
When
and
you
and
are
the
black,
it's the body
tights
yeah.
we associate it with the stripper culture. When you're
yeah.
white, you're in tights. We
right.
think
yeah.
performing
yeah.
at the New York
art.
Opera.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know, is it our own prejudice?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Black women.
Yeah.
Yes.
Their bodies. That stereotype.
Right.
The policing of black women's bodies.
Yeah.
And again, I had to check myself because I really never thought of it until there was, you know, recently a documentary of Misty Copeland,
right.
and I was looking at
yeah,
some
I think
snippets,
I saw that same thing.
And then I was thinking to myself, wait a minute, those are basically the same
right.
thing.
Right, exactly.
You know,
okay.
These
are black
so
it's, women
so
versus
it's the,
white women.
The movements, I think.
Yeah.
I
touch on
yeah.
something.
Oh, like, Cherish brought
figure.
Up an interesting topic. What did you say, Julie?
I just wanted to touch on something really quickly. I'm a internet hub, so I like to stay on the internet, and what I saw was there's a costume that Michael Jackson wore quite a few years ago, and
mm-hmm.
it resembles Beyonce's, and I was like, did she do this on purpose?
Mm-hmm.
Like, what is she trying to say?
Yeah. Many people saw it was an homage to Michael Jackson.
And
yeah.
then
wow.
the same, and then he mentioned Kendrick, same thing with Kendrick, like Michael Jackson, I mean, Kendrick had on like blue, like these blue, kind of like mismatchy
yeah,
blue jean
mm-hmm.
suit thing, and MJ had it on too, so I'm like, is there like some kind of correlation? Are they trying
mm-hmm.
to tell us something? Or was that just like proper style?
Right. Mm. So, for a last question, and I did fortunately did not see this, but according to my students online, a lot of supposedly white folks kind of went crazy over this video.
Yeah,
they did.
As a white person, I didn't get that. My students will tell
security.
You I get angrier
yeah.
at
yeah,
police brutality than they do. And I'm always telling them, go protest, but nicely. Don't get shot.
Okay.
Right. So I mean, I think this video, I agree with the gentleman. It could have gone further. Could have been more in your face. A lot of white people are apparently.
I
mean, it's not on YouTube anymore.
Any further,
right.
the video
close
to NWA. Like it would have been a little reckless.
Right. So, do you all want to respond to that? I mean, why? If you compare it to the hip hop of the 80s with NWA and all that, this was lovely.
Yeah, it was like,
dear,
yeah,
no one's getting killed.
Yeah.
So, do you all want to respond to that? I'm not asking you to explain white folks, because
I mean, I don't really
you know,
understand.
But anyone want to give that a try?
Sure.
Sure, Cherish. Get you in the mind of a white Southerner. Just for the record,
I'm going to
get you some sweet tea.
Right.
Some sweet tea.
Why? Okay, so why were they so upset?
Yeah, what is why? If you compare it to NWA and some of the other stuff that's
been out there.
They just didn't
first
expect
reason
that
I think
out of
that they were upset is because she's a woman.
And it's Beyonce.
And it's Beyonce.
There's
like,
a woman.
And they didn't expect
it's
that out of her.
They made a whole life.
Yes. It's like you betrayed
us. Did you see it? It was a video on Saturday Night Live, and they had little snippets of her, you know, doing the music video, and then they had a white lady, and she was like, oh my God, honey, what is she doing? It's it's Beyonce. And he was like, yeah, calm down. Like, just relax, it's Beyonce.
And Beyonce, for a lot of white people, is like Michael Jackson. So yeah, these right. are people that they think, okay, I can let my relate daughter or my son right. listen to them, and I know that there will be no ridiculously radical, you know, ideologies being passed through certain songs.
So it's shocking to them.
Formation, and it's okay, ladies, now let's get in formation. Prove to me that you have dedication. Slay, bitch, or you'll get eliminated. Exactly. It's like, what are you talking about?
But what is she talking about?
I was going to say so much.
All right. Before we get into that, anybody want to respond to this white people crazy?
I mean, honestly, I don't really know why they outraged, but they did take it as far as saying that they weren't gonna. They took her security away at a concert, like at one of her concerts.
Well, they were threatening.
They took it as far as that. It was too far. I don't know why they did her like that, but it's too much.
Hey, Jaleesa, you want to speak on that?
I think like how Cherish said, like Beyonce is like the kind of Michael Jackson for like this kind of generation, this present time. And you know, Beyonce, she pleases people. She's a people pleasing artist, not like maybe. I can't think of anybody right now, but
Rihanna.
Rihanna pushes people's boundaries a little bit, and because people get kind of uncomfortable when she speaks about certain things, and when she uses like her native like accent, people are like, "What are you saying?" She's like, "This is why she doesn't like portray herself as an islander like that, because people like kind of make fun of her accent." So now Beyonce's going with this thing that. She's like making a huge statement, and it makes white people uncomfortable because they know that she's right for the most part.
In that regard, what you were saying, she's gone too far. If she's now scaring white people away to where they don't listen to the message, did she go too far?
No.
Would it have been better to clothe it in a more neutral message so that white people might listen?
No. I think it's good the way it is.
Americans upset.
Yeah.
All right, Amber.
I'm like, uh-oh.
I think his hands up first.
All right, gentlemen in the glasses.
What you were saying about why people got so angry, it happens a lot with when there's...
White people are angry about a lot.
Whenever African Americans as a whole try and show some type of power or, you know, some unity, it always, you know, they always find a way to discredit it. Beyonce in the Super Bowl with the Black Panthers, everybody had a problem with that. Even when the hashtag Black Lives Matter, they come out with All Lives Matter. So
right, like, of course all lives matter.
But that's what we're saying.
Right.
We're the ones getting shot.
Amber?
I believe when it comes to, like, white people are getting upset about her video and or her Super Bowl show. I think that they were more, they felt betrayed. Like, we gave you this platform. We let you in to be this famous because really the industry is owned by rich white men, as we all know. So we let you do this and it's how you pay us back. I feel like they felt like, yeah, it was like, okay, but how dare you?
They're
like, you're gonna take that,
you're
gonna take your security.
Now
we're
gonna do
this. Wow. Yeah,
that
would live. Oh, yes. The first thing is that I think that the reason why black people are angry about it. And I don't think they're going to be angry for long. That's my second reason. My first reason that they're not angry about it is because the same thing that they're saying, she's uncontrollable. Like, let's say like a little known album artist or not well so known artist, you control how far his or her music goes.
Well, like an Erykah Badu.
Right.
Yeah.
Beyonce, the industry cannot control how far her music goes because it's already everywhere. So whatever she puts out, if she puts out something today, it's going to reach the same audience. Right. And I'll tell you the second reason. The reason why people are not going to be mad for long goes into what I was saying before, is because we're settling for it, because us as black people, we're going to say, that's good, well, that's all we need. So they know that that's going to be the only thing that she puts out there until either something major happens or it has to be a long time until it happens or until she puts out something again, because they're going to say, you know, they're going to keep listening to it because they know that's going to be the only thing she puts out until a little while. Right, it's the same thing with if somebody is killed right now in Albany and the government official is not going to do anything until it's just like a constant boom, 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 boom. We're knocking on the door. That's one knock and we're going to settle for it. So they're going to keep listening to her because it's only one knock.
Right. Yeah, I feel like she's such a big role model.
I think, well, first of all, I think that the reason why they got some folks got upset is to kind of paraphrase the famous Rick James when he says, what he was said to have said, you know, cocaine is a hell of a drug. White supremacy is a hell of a drug.
Yeah. Yeah.
And once you hooked onto it, in which you are the center of the universe, and once you have an instance where you're not at that center, then you get withdrawals, mm-hmm. and as we know, people with withdrawals get cranky. Mm-hmm. So I think that, and I think that, you know, she took the Beyonce needle out of their arm, and they didn't know what to do.
Went culture.
Yeah, and the second thing I want to say is that, again, I just really support artists being inspired and to give music that inspires them. I love Marvin Gaye. Marvin Gaye did, of course, that quintessential album, What's Going On. But then his last hit was Sexual Healing. I mean, people are complex. People have different things that are on their minds.
Right.
And so, so I don't necessarily think that all of her music needs to be about this.
Right.
I would just hope that her music reflects what she's being inspired by.
Okay.
Because I think that's we as humans, that's what we connect to, the human experience. And the human experience is Martin Luther King Jr. wasn't marching every day. Sometimes he went to the barbecue and played some pool or play with his children. I mean, it's, black lives are more than just struggle. Black lives are the full extent of the human experience. And that's, especially teaching African-American literature, oftentimes I have students, I'm like, look, it's not just struggle and, you know, people were happy. You're here. Somebody had sex. People went to the party. I mean, they weren't just sitting around saying, woe is me, our lives are over. They were actually making beautiful art. They were living dynamic lives, and we need to celebrate that as they were obviously you know, going against oppression. You could do more than one thing at one time. I know, I'm a mom.
All right, thank you, Cherish.
I think that, back to my first point, is that the reason that this video made so many people mad is because she is a woman. I really do believe that. I don't think it's anything else other than that, because even, like, I think that, at least for me, in my opinion, a lot of times when I think about Formation, I'm only thinking about the video. The video had images that had nothing to do with what she was actually saying.
True.
So, you know, a lot of the things, like a lot of her lyrics for the song, they were really feminist. You know, when he has good sex, I'll take him to Red Lobster. When he is providing me with something, when he makes me satisfied, then I will reward him with taking him to Red Lobster. Versus what we typically hear, which is when a woman is doing something right, she'll get rewarded.
Right.
So I think that, like, really, that was empowerment. That her feminist standpoint, it was so, like,
to be the dominant,
so powerful.
Voice.
It's like, switch what the are roles. You talking about?
Yeah,
like,
it's the misogyny.
Yes,
that,
that's
yeah,
all reversed.
That Amber was talking about this morning.
Yep. I think you have to get that. You have to. You somewhat have to talk about misogyny before you talk about racism, for me, in my opinion, because they tie together.
On that super awesome point,
I
misogyny.
One question.
One thing.
Yeah. Okay. Fine.
Since Beyonce is married to Jay-Z, what would happen if Jay-Z did the same thing?
Like, yeah, but he has, because he's a rapper.
And did the Formation video. Like,
but
what
he does
rap
about, like, giving her bags and all kinds of things.
See, I wonder,
right, he already did.
Yeah, probably.
White people are generally, we talked about this, very afraid of the black brute, right?
Yeah.
So to have a man rap about that, but at the same time, the idea of a woman
same
stepping it outside
and then she's a black woman.
Right.
So,
like, whoa.
Right, it's even more powerful.
But thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, no, I'm not doing that.
Do our dance room?
Did we have one?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, the.